skin, a physically independent neural network.
Some scientists refer to this as the singularity.
Professor?
I call it transcendence.
Will's body is dying, but his mind is a pattern of electrical signals. We can upload his consciousness. We can save him.
In science fiction films, the brains of scientists are downloaded into computers.
Oh my God, it's like my mind has been set free.
Criminal brains in bubbling jars connected with the internet. Interesting, but how does it work in real life? Science journalist Rob van Hattem wondered what information we can get from our brain and stumbled upon an extraordinary scientific experiment. An experiment that opens the door to a world in which brains are joined to form one big biocomputer, a brain net. This is what you can expect.
To see that a brain had finally liberated itself from the physical limits of the body and was acting in the world through the movements of a robotic device that he could not even conceive what it was.
Deze elektrodes, wat je hier ziet, dat hij heel netjes hieronder geschoven wordt. En dat hij precies op het hersengebied terechtkomt waarvan wij weten dat het aangaat als je terugtelt of als je je vingers wilt bewegen.
We want to really go so far that people imagine a word or a letter and we can directly see this on the patterns of activity. Small, tiny patterns which differentiate one letter from the other letter. This is our goal.
Welcome to the greedy brain. This is my head, my skull. X-rays illegally made by my sister-in-law when I was 20. Just because I wanted to see my brain. But those X-rays didn't tell me much. Ever since my philosophy studies, I've been fascinated by the brain and computers. Is the brain a biocomputer? Can we retrieve information directly from the brain and save it? Can the brain function without the body? Now, 35 years later, these questions are becoming topical subjects. Now there are neuroengineers, using scanners, fast electronics and powerful computers. They look into the brain in real time, plant electrodes into gray cells. They read out brain signals and use them to operate computers. Predicting is very difficult, especially the future, so the physicist Niels Bohr once said. But it looks like we can get more and more out of the brain, and we can directly connect our brains. It sounds like science fiction, but reality is closer than we think. A year ago, an intriguing scientific article was published. Two rat brains were electrically connected. The left rat, the transmitter, was given a reward when pressing the correct lever. The brain signal of the transmitter rat was tapped and transmitted to the right rat, the receiver, through a direct connection. The right rat was to press the same lever. In 70% of the cases, the receiver rat made the correct choice, and as the experiment progressed, it did better and better. Apparently, the receiver rat's brain was able to understand the signal of the transmitter rat. Interesting detail. The transmitter rat was in the US. The receiver rat was in Brazil. Their brains were connected through the internet. If brains can understand each other's signals, then imagine what we can do with those signals. The experiment was carried out by the Brazilian brain researcher Miguel Nicolelis, who literally hunts electrical signals in the brain.
I joke that, you know, most of what our brain does is to produce these electrical storms that crisscross the entire brain to generate our identity, our behaviors, our memories, our predictions of the future, our remembrance of the past. And since the brain utilizes these electrical storms to encode information, I describe that in my book as neuroscientists are basically storm chasers, just brainstorm chasers. When I was a postdoc, when I moved to the United States, one of the things I learned was to basically connect my amplifiers, the ones that are getting the signals from the brain cells that I was recording, to loudspeakers. And I did that every day. And after a year, I could recognize the place in the brain that I was recording from by the sound that I was listening. I just turned on the loudspeaker and I could tell my colleague that was working with me, another postdoc, where we were recording from. I got used to the sound, and the sound is nothing that we, in fact, my younger son likes to call it like the sound of the brain, like making popcorn on a microwave while listening to a badly tuned AM station. I took him to the lab one day and he listened to that and said, well, it's just static, it looks like static. But after you listen to that for a while, you get used to it. And you can see in some cells the sound is different. And you actually learn to map the brain when you were doing these experiments by using your auditory system. So it's a very fascinating thing.
Nico Lelis is associated with Duke University in Durham in the US, where he can study brain signals to his heart's desire. He was pronounced one of the 20 most influential scientists in the US. In his book Beyond Boundaries, he describes his extraordinary experiments and far-reaching ideas. At first, he studied the brain signals of rats. Using special electrodes, he managed to receive the signal of 100 nerve cells at the same time. Especially the signals of cells that cause motion were very strong. He thought he could use those signals for an unprecedented experiment.
We decided to create this preparation that we call brain-machine interface. That means basically that you read these signals coming from, at that time, 100 cells in the brain, and you try to see if an animal or a subject can use that brain activity to control the movements of a robotic arm, let's say, and use the robotic arm as if that robotic arm were part of the subject's body, as if it were the animal's own arm. We had a rat learning to press a lever. And if he pressed a lever, a little robot would get a drop of water and bring this drop of water to the rat so he could lick it. And in a given moment in time, we disconnect the lever. So the connection between the lever and the robot was not there anymore. But if the animal imagined the movement of pressing a lever, the robot was controlled by the animal's brain activity, so the animal could continue to drink water. And the animals did, the rats did.
Nico Lelis tried the same experiment with a monkey named Aurora. First, he taught the monkey to play a robot video game using a joystick that she could simply operate manually. The brain signals were directly connected with the robot and the computer. When she mastered that game, he took away the joystick, and Aurora started to play the same game using only her brain.
Aurora was very special because, being a monkey, she could get this concept more clearly. And she was able to play a video game using a robotic arm controlled by her brain activity. So when she imagined movements of her own arm without moving her biological arm, she was able to make this robotic arm move and control a cursor that had to be placed in a target on a computer screen.
I can imagine at the moment you see that happening that it feels very strange or very...
Oh, it wasn't strange, it was elation. I mean, we were so... There were three of us it was in the middle of the night, and I don't know, 2 a.m. I don't know, something like that. But there were three of us in the laboratory running the experiment at the time, and we couldn't talk because it was so wonderful, so beautiful. To see that a brain had finally liberated itself from the physical limits of the body and was acting in the world through the movements of a robotic device that he could not even conceive what it was, and yet he was doing it, and he was getting a reward out of it. So it was a magic. For us, it was almost like a piece of magic.
But Nico Lelis' experiment didn't stop at that. A few years later, he came up with a new experiment that was to result in a major project for which a special promotion film was made.
In 2008, we decided to stage what I'd been calling our little moonwalk. We had a monkey running on a treadmill at Duke University in the US, producing the brainstorms necessary to move. And we had a humanoid robot in Kyoto, Japan. The brain activity was transmitted to Japan and made the robot walk.
A good friend of mine, Gordon Chang, at that time was working at ATR Laboratories in Kyoto, and he had developed a humanoid robot, CB1, that had all the mechanics ready to walk, but the only thing he was missing was some sort of a brain to control, you know, these beautiful joints and all the motors that he had and to walk. And I went to Kyoto when I met Gordon for the first time, and I joked to him, look, I can lend you a brain. You know, we have these monkeys in the United States. We can send you brain activity through the internet, and maybe you can make your robot walk under the control of a primate or a monkey's brain. And he said, okay, let's try that. And we actually succeeded.
Footage of this walking was sent back to Duke so that the monkey could see the legs of the robot walking in front of him. But as the treadmill and the monkey stopped, the robot continued to walk, following the uninterrupted instructions that flowed from the monkey's brain, almost as if the robot had become an extension of his own self.
As long as we rewarded the monkey for the correct stepping of the robot, the monkey would continue to imagine the movements of locomotion and make the robot walk in Japan. So the monkey didn't need to walk, it just needed to imagine walking. And that's when we categorically realized that this idea could work for patients who have suffered a severe spinal cord injury and cannot move anymore. Perhaps at that time, Gordon and I, you know, had almost the certainty that perhaps we could use the same principle to make patients imagine movements and use this imagination and these signals to control a exoskeleton, a robotic vest that these patients would wear to be able to walk again.
An international research consortium, the Walk Again Project, offers a first glimpse in rehabilitation medicine. A paralyzed person would be able to control parts of a wearable robotic vest and move again just by imagining the movements. We are planning one potential demonstration for the opening ceremony of the Soccer World Cup in Brazil in 2014, when a young paraplegic Brazilian will walk and shoot the opening kick of the World Cup. As my grandmother used to say, the impossible is just the possible that someone has just not put enough effort into to make it come true.
Every person's brain is a unique universe of experiences that are recorded in the connections between the nerve cells. So by planting electrodes into the brain, Nicolelis can tap those connections and directly operate machines. I would love to do that too, but sticking needles into my brain is taking it a bit too far for me. Fortunately, there's another way, by placing electrodes on the head. Consumer headsets are even put on the market that can be used to operate a cursor by looking at it, or increasing a block just by thinking about it. It's fun to play with. For the FC Dundas Institute in Nijmegen, this is serious business. Pieter Dessin develops brain-computer interfaces for games and medical applications.
Peter?
Ja?
Jij kan mijn hersensignalen hoorbaar maken, hè?
Ja, want...
Dit zijn mijn hersensignalen.
Dit zijn jouw hersensignalen, we kijken daarnaar. We meten de elektrische activiteit met een elektrode op je schedel. Ja. Dat zit dus heel ver van al die zenuwcellen af die allemaal aan het vuren zijn en zorgen dat je blijft staan.
Dit is wat ik uitzend naar buiten eigenlijk.
Precies. Dus het zijn hele kleine signaaltjes. Maar wat je er af en toe als grote signalen tussen ziet, zijn de signalen van de spieren, dus niet van je hersenen. Dus yes. Kou maar even bijvoorbeeld. Je ziet onmiddellijk dat het het hele signaal verstoort. Voor ons zijn dat eigenlijk stoorsignalen.
Oh ja, als ik met mijn gezicht beweeg, dan krijg je enorme uitslagen.
En met je ogen knippert.
Ook met mijn ogen knippert zelfs, ja, inderdaad.
Je ziet ook hoe ingewikkeld dat signaal is. Hè. Hier kan je heel moeilijk iets aan aflezen, omdat er van alles gebeurt in je hersenen en je naar al die signalen tegelijk luistert. Wat we nu hebben gedaan is op een bepaalde manier het signaal in toonhoogte omhoog geschoven, zodat je het ook kan horen. Ik zal het wat aanzetten.
Oh jeetje, het lijkt wel een soort onweer gelijk. Dit zijn mijn hersensignalen.
Dit zijn jouw neuronen die aan het vuren zijn en die je nu kan horen.
De elektrische activiteit van mijn brein.
Ja, nu. Ja. We kunnen het ook op een wat andere manier nog afbeelden. Dan klinkt het misschien wat aangenamer. Ja, nou, langzamerhand wordt het signaal weer heel rustig. En hier zie je zo van die oscillaties in ontstaan. Ook als je je ogen dicht hebt vooral. Wat we heel goed kunnen zien is als er niks gebeurt. En als je dan gaat praten, dan gebeurt er in je hersenen natuurlijk heel erg veel. Woorden moeten worden gevonden, ze moeten in de juiste volgorde worden gezet. De betekenis moet kloppen met wat je wil zeggen. Ook je spraakspieren moeten worden aangestuurd. Maar die spieren die gooi je dus roet in de eten bij deze meting. Want die
ja, als ik nu ga praten dan, en bewegen, dan gaat hij gelijk weer verstoren. Ja. Die harde spikes, dat zijn dan toch die spierbewegingen eigenlijk.
Ja, die signalen van spieren die zijn 10, 100, soms nog groter dan wat je aan hele kleine signaaltjes uit de hersenen meet. Waar we nou meestal naar zoeken, is hele specifieke activiteit die ook reflecteert wat je aan het doen bent. En bijvoorbeeld voorgestelde beweging, hè, voor mensen die verlamd zijn, die kunnen zich beweging nog wel een voorstellen. En het signaal lijkt dan bijna op als je echt beweegt. En dat kunnen we detecteren. Selectieve aandacht, je aandacht op links of op rechts richten, met je oren of met je ogen, is ook een groot signaal. Dat kunnen we goed terugvinden.
Dit is een leuk speeltje, maar dat moet je dan wel met een echte systeem doen.
Dat moet je met een goede cap doen en met goede signaalverwerking. En dit is eigenlijk een grapje om het maar hoorbaar te maken.
Vastzetten.
Ja. Ga ik nou even opmeten of de kap ook in het midden zit.
Dit is wel heel andere koek dan een paar van elektrodes van mijn headset, hè?
Ja, dit zijn elektrodes die veel preciezer kunnen meten. En daarom spuiten we wat gel in om ook een heel goed soort contact te maken. We meten dan eigenlijk wel hetzelfde signaal, elektrisch signaal, EEG. En waar we mee bezig zijn is dan om goed te detecteren waar je je aandacht op richt. En we gebruiken dat voor mensen die helemaal verlamd zijn en niet meer kunnen communiceren. Bijvoorbeeld bij ALS heb je dat aan het eind van de ziekte. Dan kan je wel ruiken, horen, voelen, zien, maar niet meer praten en niet meer bewegen. En dan ben je dus helemaal ingesloten als het ware. Maar je hersenactiviteit is er nog wel allemaal. Dus als we die goed kunnen detecteren, kunnen we daar iets mee gaan besturen. En wat we hier doen is nu voor dat soort mensen het mogelijk maken dat ze kunnen typen. Je richt je aandacht dan, en in dit geval is het visuele aandacht, op een plek op het scherm waar een letter staat die je wil doorsturen. Die letters knipperen allemaal, de vlakjes daarachter, met een net iets ander patroon. En op grond daarvan kunnen we voorspellen wat je hersensignaal zou zijn als je naar die letter zou kijken. En dan kijken we naar het echte hersensignaal en waar die het meest op lijkt. Dan zeggen we, oh, je was blijkbaar, had je aandacht op die letter gericht, dus die moeten we doorsturen.
Tegenlicht.
Nou, het is gelukt. Het kostte enige moeite, moet ik zeggen. Ja. Want je moest steeds backspacen en dan weer de goede letter. Dus nog niet helemaal dat je denkt, hij leest mijn brein correct uit. Maar het is wel een beetje magie eigenlijk.
Ja, ja. Maar je ziet hoe betrouwbaar je eigenlijk moet zijn. En zeker voor patiënten die ook snel vermoeid worden.
Spannend.
Natuurlijk. Eigenlijk wil je natuurlijk dat je alleen maar aan de letter E wil hoeft te denken. En dat hij dan hem oppikt. Dat je niet eens meer naar zo'n knipperende matrix hoeft te kijken.
Kan dat?
Nou, met zo'n EEG-cap gaat dat nooit lukken. Dat zijn zulke kleine representaties. Maar invasief, als je werkt met geïmplanteerde elektroden, zijn die signalen wel veel preciezer. Dan zou dat kunnen.
Theoretisch
mogelijk. Ja, dat beginnetjes in die richting zijn al gemaakt. Ja.
Peter Dessin not only develops medical brain-computer interfaces. This test teaches the brain to react more strongly if the tone changes. That signal is used to focus video. The better the brain perceives the tone change, the better the focus of the video. He wants to use this installation to increase the speed of learning a language. Some languages contain tone sounds that our brain is not quite used to. By using the focusing of the video as a feedback, the brain learns to recognize the differences in tone much more quickly. Another installation at the lab is just for fun.
Dit is een spelletje, blikwerpen. Je gaf net al aan dat het bijna magisch was hoe je de letters op het scherm kon laten verschijnen door te kijken. Nou, dit is eigenlijk een mentaal balletje wat jij straks tegen een van de blikken
mag. Mentaal balletje?
Een mentaal balletje is dit.
Oké.
Het geheel is een grap, een gadget.
Je begint allemaal te flikkeren.
Om uit te leggen wat we doen. En nu is de computer weer informatie aan het verzamelen over jouw responsen van je hersenen.
En dan ga ik zo'n mentale balletje begonnen. Oh, oké. En nu?
Hij was raak.
Hij was raak, ja, dat was duidelijk. Maar oh, ik kan nog steeds zeggen. Die laatste nog, hè? Ah.
Die was mis.
Die was mis, ja.
Die was in de gordijn.
De laatste is altijd het lastigste.
The brain gets used to this type of readout techniques fairly quickly.
Yes.
According to Mikhail Nikolelis, this is not so strange. After all, the brain is a greedy organ. It will seize every opportunity to control the outside world, and in doing so, making the world part of the brain itself.
Our cars, our soccer balls, piano, violins, everything that we use on a daily basis and that allows us to become proficient tool users seem to happen because the brain assimilates this as part of us.
But it also suggests that car is a part of us.
Yes, sometimes you don't even consciously remember the movements that you made to go from point A to point B, because your brain literally is controlling that car as if it were your limb, your leg, or your arms. And you can feel the asphalt, you know, very well, the texture, the vibration, the effects of the road can be sensed by your body as if you're touching with your fingertips, but you're not. You're holding to a steering wheel. So our sense of self can be extended to incorporate the technology that we create and utilize them every day to interact with the world.
All kind of experiments that Nikolaidis has carried out confirm the greed of the brain. For example, he installed infrared sensors and magnetic sensors on rats and connected them with their brain. This way, the rats could sense infrared light and magnetic fields. After a while, the rat's brain understood that a reward was waiting at an infrared source, or a magnetic field.
What we did was to route infrared information acquired by an infrared detector. Since this detector produces electrical output, we delivered this small, tiny electrical output to the tactile cortex of rats. And after a few weeks of training, what we say is that these rats acquire the ability not to see the light, it continues to be invisible, but to touch the light. Because every time an infrared beam appeared on the environment where they were located, they would feel like a tactile stimulation in the face. And they learn to track this source of light. So to some degree, we created a channel for infrared processing, not through the visual system, but through the tactile system. And when we look at the brain of the animals, the neurons were responding both to touch of the face, normal touch, but also to infrared light. So we created cells that could basically process both channels of sensory information.
Could you do that with all kinds of signals?
Yes, in theory you could have a Geiger counter connected to the tactile cortex, and the tactile cortex would feel radioactive sources. You could have X-ray, you could have ultrasound, you know. Yeah, in theory, this adaptation that we made could be take advantage of any physical energy out there.
But that sounds as science fiction.
It used to be science fiction, yes, but it's not anymore.
If you want to allow a person with spinal injury to walk in an operable skeleton, that person will have to feel their feet on the ground. But spinal injury patients can't feel their legs. The trick that Nicolelis came up with was to place vibrating elements on the forearm. Three on each arm that vibrate as the feet unwind. The person to do the kickoff is trained by means of virtual reality, so that they can feel the unwinding of the feet on the arm.
I feel a telephone on my arm. And it's now ringing. It's ringing continuously, actually. Fine. Yep.
Okay. So let's have the avatar walk.
Yeah, around. Okay, so now. Sort of feeling that you just put your feet down and as if you roll your feet.
We are working with patients that don't have sensory feedback from their legs. So the idea here is to substitute that missing sensory from the legs on the forearm so the patient can have a feeling of where their legs are without them looking down or them staring on the floor and to see where they're, if their legs are touching the floor or not.
It's actually giving back the feeling of walking.
Exactly. Yeah. By this sensory motor kind of integration, the subject might feel the robotic leg as being part of their own body. They feel the position, the feeling of the leg on their forearm, and they have the feeling of touching the floor.
It's a new sense. Actually, you're creating a new sense of walking.
Correct. Yeah. We can see it that way.
Interesting.
I write and produce murder mystery parties. I started doing this in Pittsburgh.
Jan Scheuermann was a healthy woman until she was diagnosed with spinocerebellar degeneration. In a few weeks' time, she became paralyzed from the head down. At Pittsburgh University Hospital, she became a test subject in an experiment in which an implant with hundreds of electrodes was placed in her brain. With those electrodes, she learned to operate a robotic arm. And that worked pretty well. Within weeks, her brain had mastered the arm.
I used to have to think up, clockwise, down, forward, back. Now I just look at the target. It's not a matter of thinking which direction anymore. It's just I want to do that, and my brain knows what things to move to make that happen.
But for now, this is only an experiment. The doctors think they will need at least another 10 years to make the system better and especially more reliable. Still, brain implants may soon be very common. Neurosurgeons at the Utrecht University Medical Center want to place the electrodes of the researcher Nick Ramsey into a real patient very soon. Electrodes that the patient's brain can tolerate for a longer period of time and that are highly reliable.
We gaan iets implanteren bij mensen die locked in zijn, dus die niet meer kunnen bewegen, niet meer kunnen praten, die alleen maar met oogknippers of misschien een heel klein beetje met een ledemaat kunnen bewegen. Die willen we iets geven waarmee ze direct een computer kunnen aansturen. Dit is het kastje wat onder de huid gaat. Het kastje zelf komt hier onder de huid te zitten. En dan gaan deze draden naar boven toe. En dan krijgen we deze elektrodes. Die gaan onder de schedel, komen die op hersengebiedjes te liggen die wij dan precies hebben vastgesteld met een MRI-scan van tevoren. Ik kan wel even laten zien op de hersenen. Hier hebben we een geprint brein. Dus dit is de schedel. En hier heb je de hersenen. Dus van een werkelijke MRI-scan van iemand. Daar hebben we dan twee gaten in geboord. En de bedoeling is dan dat we deze elektrodes, wat je hier ziet, dat hier heel netjes hieronder geschoven wordt. En dat u precies op het hersengebied terechtkomt waarvan wij weten dat het aangaat als je terugtelt of als je je vingers wilt bewegen. Het kastje dat luistert dan naar de signalen in de hersenen. Het versterkt het, want het is heel zwak. En die stuurt het draadloos naar buiten en dan zitten wij klaar met een ontvanger en een computer die dat decodeert. En wat die patiënt uiteindelijk moet kunnen, wat het doel is van het onderzoek, is dat hij door
ergens aan te denken, een muisklik kan genereren. En waarom is dit, ja, vergeleken bij collega's in Amerika die robotarmen aansturen, dat is daar een grote markt. Het enorme verschil dat wij hebben is dat we 100% betrouwbaarheid willen hebben. Dus we willen dat dit systeem alleen maar een muisklik genereert als de gebruiker het wil. En dat is, ja, de meeste groepen die zitten rond de 80%, dus 8 van de 10 keer lukt het. En 2 van de 10 keer ziet het apparaat iets wat je niet wilt of hij reageert niet. En wij willen ze tegen die 100% aan zitten. En 80% is voor iemand die verlamd is helemaal niet interessant. En het is te vergelijken met als jouw toetsenbord elke 5e letter verkeerd op het scherm zet. En dan binnen 10 minuten gooi je hem tegen de muur aan. Dus voor de implantaat moet je een heel stuk beter zijn. Dus wat wij proberen is heel simpel, heel bazaal, een muisklik. En als dat eenmaal lukt, dan gaan we de volgende stap, daar zijn we ook al mee bezig. En dan gaan we proberen om gedachten of taal te decoderen. Dus je kunt tegen jezelf praten in je hoofd. En dat veroorzaakt ook activiteitspatronen. En dan hebben we heel andere elektrodes. Dan hebben we hele dichte matjes. Dat zijn deze, daar liggen elektrodes heel dicht tegen elkaar aan. Want de hersenen hebben enorm veel detail. Ja, dus elke vierkante millimeter die heeft een andere functie. En hiermee kunnen we dan patronen herkennen die gekoppeld zijn aan het uitspreken van een letter, van een U of een A. Als je dat je inbeeldt, dat is het doel van het onderzoek, dan willen wij dat kunnen decoderen. Dat kunnen we dan ook weer aan een computer koppelen. Dan kun je een spraakcomputer instellen.
The neurosurgeons don't take any chances. The four of them go over the procedure for the upcoming surgery.
Wat zien jullie nu met dit kunsthoofd aan het doen?
Nou, hier zijn we aan het kijken of we heel precies de plaats kunnen bereiken waar we de elektrodes willen leggen. Dat moet op de millimeter nauwkeurig. En dat is nog niet eerder gedaan, dus het moet hier echt ontwikkeld en uitgeprobeerd worden.
Het is echt een uitproberen operatie.
Het is de tweede al, dus we weten al wat we moeten doen. Alleen nou controleren of het goed gaat doen.
Ja. 3D printing of brains has become an everyday thing. This is possible because with ever-enhancing scanners we can map out the entire brain. The X-ray of my head when I was 20 was not all that great. X-rays don't penetrate bone. Now things are quite different. And I finally have the chance to see my own brain in very high resolution.
What I would need you to do is put these ear plugs in to protect you against the noise of the magnet.
In Maastricht, a hyper-modern center for brain research has recently opened. They have the best MRI scanners in the world. A Tesla 3 is the least, but we go for the Tesla 7. The Tesla 9 is unfortunately still under construction. The center is the brainchild of researcher Rainer Goebel. Only few scientists are so committed to the brain as he is.
Already in high school I was called Synapse because I liked the brain a lot and read about the brain. Even we have not even that in classes in high school. I don't know what it is. I was fascinated in two things. Space and brain. And I was not sure what I should study. Then the brain won at the end. So I studied psychology, neuroscience, computer science, because I programmed this all myself. And, you know, to program something to see the brain better gives me a lot of satisfaction because, you know, I help other people to do better brain research, to visualize it in new ways. So that integrates a lot of my interests.
You developed a lot of software where you see the brain. Whose brain is it?
On the iPad, for example, on Android phones, this is actually my wife's brain. She's kind of in many textbooks, in many apps I program. So she's kind of, I know her brain pretty well by now.
All right, we now start the anatomical scan, okay? Great, 6 minutes.
Resolution. that's nice.
Yeah, do that for the subcortical structures.
For me, the exciting part is that we can observe the brain at work. So we see what is active when you talk to yourself, when you think about a poem, or when you kind of mentally draw. We see which parts become activated. So we see the substrate of the mind in the brain. This is what fascinates me.
It's a little scary, I'll admit that. Suppose they find something.
So now, Rob, we see all the details of your brain. Very nice images. You will be happy afterwards.
Fortunately, nothing is wrong. The MRI scanners are becoming more and more powerful. The power is expressed in Tesla. The 7 Tesla scanner that Goebbels uses is for scientific research only. This scanner has charted my entire brain to 6/10 of a millimeter.
We are not medical doctors here. Right. We really do want to understand how the brain works from all of us. And for me, this is remarkable. For example, I can find out exactly how your cortex is folded, each little detail, which is important to learn where exactly something happens in the brain. We can see whether you imagine faces. We can see whether you imagine seeing places like your house. We can see if you mentally play tennis or do some motor mental actions. We cannot see which exact face you have in your mind. We cannot see which exact word you have in your mind. But we see that you have words in your mind, but not which one. The future is that we want to really have high-resolution brain scanning, that we crack the code of the brain. So we look in your face area and don't say it's active or not, but we say, oh, there's a pattern. Ah, that pattern in the area stands for your face. Here's another pattern. Ah, that pattern stands for my face, right? So that we start to learn and zoom in tiny brain regions and decode the information in these regions. This is the future. We want to really go so far that people imagine a word or a letter and we can directly see this on the patterns of activity, small, tiny patterns which differentiate one letter from the other letter. This is our goal.
Recognizing letters in the brain. That is exactly what researcher Marcel van Greven at the Nijmegen University does. Using statistics and math, he can see what letters a test subject has seen by looking at their brain. It is in the early stages of development, but still.
Ja, dus wat we hier gedaan hebben, is we hebben mensen in een MRI-scanner gelegd. Met behulp van die scanner kunnen we hersenactiviteit meten. En we hebben een nieuw model ontwikkeld, wat ons in staat stelt om hetgene wat mensen zien te reconstrueren. Dus ik heb hier een voorbeeld. Aan de linkerkant zien we wat mensen gezien hebben in de scanner. Handgeschreven letters in dit geval. En aan de rechterkant zien we reconstructies gemaakt door ons model op basis van de gemeten hersenactiviteit.
Maar dit gaat wel vrij ver. Je kan bijna, zou bijna kunnen zeggen, je kan meelezen met iemand.
Ja, klopt. Het is natuurlijk wel belangrijk om je te realiseren dat er een verschil is tussen waarneming, het zien van iets, en verbeelding, dus het bedenken van iets. Dus we kijken nu specifiek naar waarneming. Ik denk dat deze techniek ons uiteindelijk in staat stellen om ook verbeelding of interne gedachten beter in kaart te brengen.
Ja, want dit is echt wat je ziet, niet wat je denkt.
Klopt, ja.
An American research group has done something similar with moving images. Hours and hours in the scanner and hours of calculating resulted in this type of spotty reconstructions.
De gebieden waar de visuele informatie binnenkomt, die laten eigenlijk een vrij recht toe recht aan beeld zien van wat er in de buitenwereld gebeurt.
En het ziet eruit als ongeveer, hè? Dus ik zie een soort blobs als ik olifanten zie.
Klopt, het is nog niet perfect, maar dit is de eerste stap in deze vorm van onderzoek. En het is wel zo dat we steeds meer stappen gaan nemen om dit in meer detail te doen. Er zijn dus ook groepen bezig met meer kijken naar interne processen. Dus je kunt je voorstellen, misschien kunnen we op een gegeven moment gedachten uitlezen of dromen uitlezen.
The scanners are not just to read out the brain. They can also be used to control one's own brain. And that results in interesting new therapies.
So Rob, welcome to our 3 Tesla scanner. That's the machine we use for brain-computer interface studies now. And in the seven Tesla, you did passively looking. You had to do nothing.
Now
the results depend critically on your mind, what you are doing today.
I have to perform.
You have to perform, yes.
Okay. I have to do...
With your mind, with your brain, you basically have to kind of change signals. What you do today, we use an area where Parkinson patients, for example, help themselves to improve as a therapy.
Doe maar de taken zo goed mogelijk, okay? Niet stress.
While my brain is being scanned, I have to perform mental tasks. I'm asked to focus strongly on drawing, reciting a text, or navigating through my home. I can't move, just think. Goebel uses his MRI to read out my brain activity. Then they set the computer to my drawing area.
These little regions here, actually we can zoom in. You see, now here comes the activity. These are his brain, the regions which become activated now.
Then they show me a kind of meter and ask me to focus mentally on drawing as strongly as I can. The more focused I am, the more white squares appear.
Dus je moet zelf uitproberen. Dat is een beetje de idee van neurofeedback. Wat helpt om het signaal omhoog te krijgen? Ik ga me iets voorstellen als sneller tekenen, juist langzamer tekenen, iets anders tekenen.
It's a weird experience. In a matter of time, I learned to let the meter run up by just thinking about drawing.
Very good, he activates his brain now very nicely. Very nicely, yes.
Again, the brain is greedy. As long as it gets feedback, it will learn to control itself quickly too.
And this is actually the region we selected and feed it back to you. So in the thermometer, you saw yourself how active is my region here. This was the region we used.
So what I saw was the activity of my own brain.
Of your own brain, and not of the whole brain.
No, of that
but
part.
Just of this tiny part, of a few voxels. And this tiny part we found in the first run, in the first experiment, was active when you do mental drawing. So now if you do yourself mentally some drawing, you could activate yourself this region even when we wouldn't know, right? If we now use this as a therapy in patients, then we give them feedback from their emotional areas for depressed patients, for example, and they learn to kind of control and go in and out of emotions. And that helps them to control also their negative emotions, their depression. So we have already published this, and there's currently a big study running where we develop this technique you have done today. We developed this for a new therapy of depressed patients. We have published this also of Parkinson patients.
Learn to control their own
exactly
brain.
Right, and we have success. Half of the patients which where no medicament helps, so they get all since 20 years all the medicaments, all the therapies, nothing helps. With this one, they have an improvement down their symptoms of half. That is substantial, right? Some of them are even healthy now.
Because, in fact, they become their own brain readers.
Exactly, their own brain readers and modulators. Because they learn, they see in the feedback, what do I have to do to activate or deactivate this brain area? So they become a bit their own master and they feel, I can control my emotions, I can control myself. And that leads them to a new level to cope with their diseases, with their problems.
What more possibilities are there for those kind of feedbacks?
What we currently do, we have European funding to go. We have successfully shown it works in depression. It works in Parkinson's disease. We currently run a study with one of my PhD students on spider phobia. So we try to help people if they are really freaking out when they see spiders to kind of control their areas to suppress this, so to speak, or inhibit this, which seems to work quite well. We work on ADHD, so kids who cannot attend, where electroencephalography is usually used, like your emotive mm-hmm. system. But we do this with fMRI. Then we apply it now to addiction, alcohol addiction, to autistic children to help them. They cannot look at the face, they look away. And we let them learn to control their brain activity.
This way, Goebel's neurofeedback system can become a future therapy with which people can control their own ADHD, Parkinson's, phobias, and addictions. So the brain can control both its environment and itself. But brains can also control each other. That is what we learned from Mikhail Nikolaev's experiment, where two rat brains were directly connected through the internet. By connecting the brains, they became partly one. His experiments only gives us a preview of what may come.
To some degree, we got a biological system computing together. In fact, we have new experiments, I cannot talk much about it, but in which we have now monkeys interacting through what we call a brain net. That's the name we gave to this, this preparation. And we have just demonstrated that they can collaborate. Three monkeys, for instance, can collaborate to solve a problem together using a combination of their brain activity.
Brains that are connected in a network. Could the dream of the Russian internet billionaire Dmitry Itskov become true? Itskov is financing a project to separate our brain from our bodies so that we can make our brain immortal and transplant or download it into a robot or an avatar.
2030 to 2035, ReBrain. The colossal project of brain reverse engineering is implemented. World science comes very close to understanding the principles of consciousness. 2035, the first successful attempt to transfer one's personality to an alternative carrier. The epoch of cybernetic immortality begins.
It sounds like technological daydreaming. And that's exactly what Goebbels says it is. For example, the hippocampus, the working memory of the brain. Our memories are not simply there, ready to be read out.
The brain is active and the memory is only active when you do memorize. So that means the hippocampus cannot be read out, at least not now, because the synaptic connections you have, if they are not used, this technique does not give you any signal. Also, recordings don't give you any signal. So if you put an electrode in the hippocampus and you do not recall a memory, you don't get nothing. So how can you then read out the brain?
Memories can only be retrieved by activating the contact points of the neurons, the synapses in the network. Suppose you could read out all 5,000 times 100 billion synapses in the brain. What would it get you?
Then you would have the power to read out from the synaptic weights, from the kind of values, from the size of these synapses, so to speak. You have to try to decode what could be the memory which is there, because you don't know. So therefore, I think that is, for the foreseeable future, not possible.
Nicolelis sees something quite different on the horizon than downloading. The brain is also greedy enough to connect with other brains. At the end of his book, he draws a picture of what he calls a brain net. Could we, one day, down the road of a remote future, experience what it is to be part of a conscious network of brains, a collectively thinking, true brain net?
A brain net is a network of brains. It's a computing engine based on the integration of multiple brains computing simultaneously. It's a biological computer. It's not a digital device, but it's a hybrid device that involves, you know, many rat brains or many monkey brains interacting to perform a task.
And could it be human brains?
That's the big unknown. I think this is a big interrogation mark. I don't even know if we want that. You know, is a question to be answered in the future, I think.
Ich hoffe, dass Ihnen das Video gefallen hat. Klicken Sie hier, um das empfohlene Video anzusehen. Bitte abonnieren Sie unseren Kanal, um Updates über VPRO-Doc zu erhalten.